Father, we thank you for today. We pray, committing our hearts and minds into your hands at this moment as we are about to listen to your word. That you come and speak to us. Amen. Father, let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. Ready our hearts for your word. That before we leave here, each and every one of us will leave here blessed. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.
Amen.
He knows that you are no longer his. So he tries tries all he can to snatch you away from the right path. One Shakira A. Hill wrote in an article in the Relevant magazine, and I quote, "I was 8 years old, idealistic and full of hope, when God called me to use my words through writing and speaking to impact the world. It was my burning bush moment, without the actual burning bush. What I didn't know was God's calling on my life would send me on a challenging yet invigorating journey. From the moment I said yes to God, life suddenly got hard. This was shocking. If I was following God's plan and the leading of the Holy Spirit, shouldn't pursuing my God-inspired dreams have been easy?" End quote. So when you become a Christian, things get tough, don't be discouraged. Think of the patriarch Joseph, son of Jacob, who obeyed God even when faithfulness brought him difficulties. He was sold as a slave while carrying out his father's orders. He was thrown into prison because he was faithful to his master Potiphar. He could have easily agreed to what Potiphar's wife was asking him to do, but he refused. And what did that end him? But Joseph was always faithful to God, and in due time he was set down at the right hand of Pharaoh, ruler of Egypt. Daniel was faithful to God. For his safety, he could have disobeyed or denied God, but he didn't. He stayed faithful at the point of death. He wouldn't bow down to any other god apart from the God he knows, and he was punished by being thrown into the lion's den. But the God that he serves was faithful, and so he was not harmed by the lions. Abraham was instructed to go to the land he wouldn't know until God told him, all while waiting more than 20 years for God to fulfill the promise of a son. And after having the son, God told him to use him as a sacrifice. He waited more than 20 years to get the son, and after getting him, he should use him as a sacrifice. How many of us here would have obeyed this calling? We spent several days and months praying for a job, or maybe a child, or even marriage. And when God grants our prayer request, what happens? What do? We don't even come to church and say thank you. And when we are asked, what do we say? Oh, it's my job. My schedule coincides with time for service. You won't even come to church to pay your flight. Or it's my husband. Or it's my child. We start using the gift that God has given to us as an excuse for not serving him. Noah was told to build an ark, gather up two of every animal, and save the last of humanity before a flood would destroy the earth. One has to wonder how Noah managed to track down every existing animal without modern technology. A young Queen Esther asks her very own life, risks her very own life, and the genocide of her people when boldly confronting King Xerxes. Why am I giving you all these examples? I want you to know that and remember that when you answer the call of Christ, you will not be alone. Would you go through trials and temptations? Yes. The path is supposed to be straight, but the devil will not let it be that easy for you. Because he needs members, he has fallen, so he needs people to fall with him. What do you see when you are on the road, when you're traveling home or somewhere? there are curves and turns. There are times that you need to slow down or speed up. There is a traffic light and a stop sign that forces us to stop when you are in a hurry to get to your destination. But they are all there for a purpose. They are there to strengthen you. They are there to help you rely on God. They are there to help you see the greatness of God. They are there to give you a testimony so that if someone is going through the same situation, you can tell that person, hey, you are not alone. The disciples before us suffered too, but God was with them to the end, and He would not leave us. When God calls you, your friends might not understand you anymore because your purpose is not the same as theirs anymore. Your parents might forsake you, but know that you are not alone. When God called Moses in Exodus chapter 3, Moses said in verse 11, that who am I that I should go to Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt? But God said to him, that I will be with you, so never think you are alone. He that has called you into his service is faithful to grant you all that you need.
Yes.
If there are moments on your journey that you feel isolated while fulfilling God's calling, remember you have the power of the Holy Spirit in you and with you, so you are not alone. The fact that what God has called you to do is tough doesn't mean that it cannot be done. Your calling might coincide with your schedule. It might move you out of your comfort zone, but know that if you stay faithful, God will reward you when the time comes. Jesus Christ, when things got tough, said in Matthew chapter 26, verse 39, my Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me. Yet not as I will, but as you will, as your will be done. My dear parents and siblings in the Lord, God created us into this world for a purpose, to serve and worship Him. We serve God by being there for each other, preaching His word, being a good example to someone at work or in our neighborhood. Most importantly, to live in love and in unity. In our service, let us not forget to worship our God. Let us not forget to spend time with Him. There are so many distractions in the world today. We can easily be distracted. Nowadays, people don't even come to church with Bibles because we have our cell phones. And you can download the Bible app on the cell phone. It's good. But when you take the cell phone to read the Bible, you can get messages. You can get so many things that can distract you easily. So yes, the cell phones are good. But you really need your Bible too, so that you won't be distracted. Just as Jesus told Martha in Luke chapter 10, verse 38 to 42, that Mary has chosen the right thing. God wasn't saying that what Martha was doing was bad, but there's time for everything. There's time to serve God, and there's time to go on your knees. There's time to read the Bible. There's time to spend time with your God to empower you so that you can be able to face the distractions of this world. That is why the Bible is there. That is why we need to spend time with our God. As for the evil doer, coming back to Doeg, David said in Psalm 52, verse 5 through 7, that surely God will bring you down to everlasting ruin. He will snatch you up and pluck you from your tent. He will uproot you from the land of the living. The righteous will see and Here now is the man who did not make God his stronghold, but trusted in his great wealth or his power, and grew strong by destroying others. God will destroy the evildoer, but we have a role to play as Christians. Because God doesn't want someone to die in his or her sin. So even though their actions are evil, we still need to pray for them. So that just as I mentioned earlier, Saul, before he became Paul, was persecuting Christians. He thought it was good. He thought he was doing the right thing by persecuting Christians. But when God met him on his way to Damascus, he changed his purpose. He changed his plans. And he used him to win souls for his kingdom. So that should be our prayers. That no matter who or what these people are, God should change them. He is the only one that can do it. God should meet them on their way to plot evil, that they can be able to, instead of going to destroy people, they would surrender their lives to Christ and win souls for his kingdom. God has a purpose for us. Taking a Christian journey is hard because there are times that you might feel alone. There are times that the cross will be so heavy to carry. But in your difficulty, know that God is with you. In your difficulty, know that God, who has started a good thing in you, will bring it to accomplishment. Psalm 52 verse 8 through 9 says, "But I am like an olive tree flourishing in the house of God. I trust in God's unfailing love forever and ever. For what you have done, I will always praise you in the presence of your faithful people, and I will hope in your name, for your name is good." Saul wanted to kill David. But God rescued David from all his plots, and later on Saul took his own life. So I pray that our God, who has called us into his service, would help us to live a faithful life in his sight, would help us and strengthen us so that no matter how difficult the task is, we will take a step of faith and remain faithful so that when he comes in his glory, the crown of victory that he has promised his children, we would be able to receive that crown. May the Lord bless us. May the Lord continue to strengthen us in our Christian journey. May the Lord help us to find ways to serve him. May the Lord lead us to worship him wherever we find ourselves. Sundays are only one day in the week, but there's Monday, there's Tuesday, there's Wednesday, up to Saturday. What do we do with our time? Whatever we are doing in the comfort of our homes, is it pleasing God? Will God see us faithful when he comes in his glory? May the Lord bless us this morning and grant us the strength to serve him in newness of heart, and draw us closer to him each and every day that passes by, and help us to see his greatness, that we will not depart from him. In Jesus' mighty name we pray with thanksgiving. Amen. Amen.